How's everyone? It is cold out here. See if I can keep from freezing. 14 days till the 21st, and it is really on right now. The event that I took place yesterday, the very disturbing event, I was able to see it as a foreshadowing, something that foreshadows. I am convinced that the future foreshadows itself in this world. I've had just innumerable instances of that. And my first feeling was this was foreshadowing. And right now I'm looking at it and say it was foreshadowing, absolutely, because other events have been taking place now. And I understand what it's about, actually. I feel like I'm going to be protected from the events that are coming. And how is it that I'm going to have this good fortune? Well, it's not luck. It's hard work. Consistent attempts to clarify and succeeding to a large extent to do that gets you into a situation where you decide that you are going to align with the path home, which means aligning with the path of accepting reality as it is. That is the path home, accepting reality as it is and not pretending that there's going to be some problem with reality that we need to try and solve ahead of time. Anticipate it, solve it ahead of time, so when it happens, we already have the solution in hand. We don't need to do that. So seeing the overall context of the situation puts me in an advantageous situation to be able to sidestep the situation, go into sanctuary, be kept under wraps, kept safe, because I don't have any, there's no motivation for harm towards anyone else or towards me whatsoever. Because harm, all this threat and vulnerability, death and annihilation, is just modeling annihilation. That's the problem we think we're going to have in reality, is annihilation. So we're modeling it and symbolizing it in many ways, and playing different roles, the one who gets annihilated and the one who does the annihilating. And when you're willing to accept reality as it is, which is perfect, flawless, there's no more need to play that stupid game at all. No more need. So you can withdraw from that game, as it were. What I experienced yesterday was very instructive, actually. I took it as a very educational situation, even though it seemed to be very, very dangerous. I got out just before it could have turned dangerous. So in other words, I was able to leave the situation. Maybe that's a foreshadowing also, actually. So what is going to happen is that the ETs are going to come out of the closet. They're going to arrive. The person that was doing this foreshadowing for me, and I bless him for that, had this ET hat on. Looked exactly like a flying saucer on top of his head. It was all black, the black hats, which though some people know what the black hats refers to as the part of the ET agenda, with the malevolent part of it. And what I did was I shared with him. I shared I was doing some work, and I had the one thing to do the work, and I said, "Oh, here you go. Let's share back and forth that." And he said, "Oh, great, that's great." And that was before it turned really weird and really bad. So basically, I was willing to share something. And then he started claiming that he actually invented this thing that I was sharing. You know, just like, whoa, just like weird. And then this came trying to be super dominating. And I was supposed to submit to him and out of respect. And just, you know, it just came really strange. I took this whole thing to be a metaphor for what is to happen and come in the world, actually. The ETs are going to come out of the closet. And first we're going to say, oh, welcome, 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 welcome. We're so glad you're here. And we'll say, let's share. Let's all share and pool our resources and work together to get this done. Help the world, blah, blah, blah. And the ETs will say, oh, great, thank you, thank you. You're sharing everything with us, sharing with us. And then at some point they're going to start a very weird vibe will start taking place. And we'll realize, wait a minute, something isn't right. It doesn't quite feel right. And then they will start saying that, hey, we are actually the original inhabitants of this planet, and you're just like squatters, something like that, and we deserve respect. Now, in ET terminology, respect means submission. Okay, that's what it actually means. They expect that we will do their bidding. That's what respect means. I've had many encounters with ETs on the subtle levels, some on the external levels. And the one thing that they have, the malevolent ones, is this issue of respect. And it literally means that you obey them. If you don't do what they expect of you, they take that as meaning you're disrespecting them. In other words, you're a slave. Because they expect you to do what they want you, what they see as what they want you to do. If you don't, you're disrespecting them. So what I got from this encounter was this person felt I was disrespecting them just because I was doing what I needed to do. I was perfectly kind and sociable. And I was just working, doing what I needed to do, and they took that as extreme disrespect of them because I was not stopping my work and listening to what they wanted me to listen to and follow their narrative, etc. So, and they were working on snapping, going to a point of just snapping and deciding at that snapping point that they just need to eliminate us. So that is what the ET's agenda is about. First they'll come in, and it's all cooperation, and we'll welcome them with open arms. The planet trying to be neighborly, trying to be neighborly. That's just what I was trying to be, is my hometown. I'm just being neighborly. Here's a neighbor, here's someone from my hometown. Of course I'm going to smile and hi, how are you, and be nice, make nice. So what we'll do is we'll make nice, because they'll we think, oh, they're from our home place. And then suddenly things will get really weird, which is what happened there. And then they will start claiming that this is their place, really, and that you're supposed to submit to them. And then when we continue to act out our own sense of our own freedom and act according to what we feel is right and just and reasonable, they will snap. They will snap. And at that point, as I say, the culling will take place in the future. So. What I was shown very graphically as a foreshadowing of what's going to take place in this world. I was moved very quickly. I got my stuff done and then got out of there before it snapped. So I would say to all of you, it's super important to have this context in your mind, recognizing the future is there is a snapping point in the future. However things seem to be going, it's heading towards a snapping point. And you want to get out of this situation before that snapping point. So I'm certainly willing to go ahead first and work to try and set up some type of underground railway system, so to speak. Like in the Civil War, the people from the South who wanted to escape, mostly the ex-slaves, there was an underground railroad getting them to the north, to safety, as it were. And really, there's a need for an underground railroad system to get people, relocate them somehow, away from perhaps this planet, because the snapping point will be reached. That was very clear. And I realized there's nothing I could do about it. In fact, anything that I would try to do wasn't going to work, because I did try. I absolutely tried. I did stuff that was very kind and humorous and offering just conciliatory, obviously very friendly gestures, and it had no effect, zero effect, none. That's what was so shocking to me. That's what was so scary, because in any other type of human that I've ever met, you act that way and they're going to at least acknowledge it in some way. It's just human nature, right? In this case, there was no acknowledgement whatsoever. That's what scared me. That's what said, oh, that's what alarmed me. And I said, whoa, this is something completely different. That's I'm not used to this at all. And that's when I, whew, okay, I'm out of here. So the ETs do not have that humanity within them. And when we offer gestures of friendliness and conciliation and do what we feel is right to say, hey, you know, we respect you, everything's okay, we respect ourselves too, mutual respect here, they won't listen. It won't work. So what we has always worked for us in human nature won't work with the ETs. It will not work. And that's when people will say, oh my God, we are in for it. But fortunately, there are those who have seen this ahead of time and have pre-planned ahead of time. Now, one of those is the one that's referred to as Jesus Christ, who knew all about this thousands of years ago. This has all been foreseen what's happening, because it actually has been in the planning stages for a long time. This takeover of the planet. Planet Earth has been in planning stages for a long time. And there are contingency plans, absolutely contingency plans. When Jesus left, they asked him, where are you going? He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. I'll come back and take you to that place. Very simple. So there is some sort of underground railroad system in play here for the world. Now, this may seem like science fiction, but it's not. If you've been watching the signs, the red flags, you realize there is some agenda taking place in this world. You know it. Nobody can tell you otherwise, because you absolutely know there is some agenda. You may not quite see exactly how it is, or you may be trying to get too many details of how it's going to play out, and you're losing the big picture. Don't get lost in the forest because you're looking at the trees. See the forest as a whole, so to speak. Don't worry about too many details. You can see intent. What I do is I tend to be able to see intent. And when you can read intent, then you can recognize what's going to happen by and large, because what happens has intent behind it. Nothing happens of its own. It happens because of intent. And so I was given this foreshadowing experience of what's going to happen here. And I just kind of said, okay. Wow. All right, let's get to work. And then I've had follow-up situations. There's going to be a massive temper tantrum in the world. People are going to snap. They'll be snapping all over the place. And in fact, they are snapping. I've stopped watching the news. I'm so tired. Every day you look on the news and someone has snapped, or many situations around the world, people have simply snapped. It used to be fairly rare, actually, people snapping. It did happen, of course. Yes, it happens. But now it is just a regular occurrence. It's like popcorn. You know, put a bag of microwave popcorn, which I don't recommend because I apparently have some stuff that's not good for you, in the microwave, and you're heating it up, nothing, and maybe pop one, and then nothing, and pop another one, and then pop, like that, it just the whole bag just suddenly just it all goes off. It's just like that. The pressure is ratcheted up here. You have a few crazy incidents of people going off, and then you have some more. It's more frequent. My gosh, it's unbelievable the stuff that's happening. Locking down schools and locking down universities, and it just seems like there's always someone snapping. And it's people you don't expect, and it's just like, what is going on here? That's part of the situation that we're going towards, is the incredible pressure put on the world. And behind this is what the takeover of this planet by extraterrestrials is something I have been following my entire life, watching very carefully and observing this entire situation. And it is the blueprint has been unfolding exactly as they have planned it out. And I don't see any way that they're not going to succeed at what they're doing. And I don't believe that they will be stopped. Absolutely not. It's gone way, way too far now. Way too far. There isn't the clarity and the will to stop it, actually. So it is going to happen. This kind of really brought it home in a very graphic way, very direct way. It is going to happen. They are going to arrive. They are going to be here. They expect us to first cooperate and then later on submit. Submit. That's their agenda. Us to submit to their authority, their direction, and their implementation of where they want us to be, what they want us to do. In other words, no real freedom from us, for us. No real freedom for us. They view us as inferior, severe inferiors that are simply like drones. They view us like as drones, as useless squatters, drones who don't know how to handle their business. And they expect us to submit to their guidance because they feel, of course, they'll say, well, we've been destroying the planet. in no large part thanks to all their technology that they have brought into this planet, by the way, and as a good excuse for them to come in, right? It's a great excuse for them to come in and say, hey, we need to take over because look what you've done. You've messed everything up. I don't believe humanity would have messed everything up so badly if it hadn't been for the extraterrestrials actually meddling here and providing a pretext for them to come in and say, look, you humans, you're destroying the planet, and we need to come in here and help you. Classic maneuver, isn't it? Classic maneuver. So then they will expect us to submit, and like cattle, we'll be like donkeys or like oxen or something to them. Basically, we're just convenient slaves to do the work they want to have done, to try and produce results. They're result oriented. ETs are very result oriented. They're oriented towards efficiency of results, and because that's what the purpose of existence is try to solve this problem of annihilation. This hypothetical problem of annihilation. So the ETs are super oriented that way, and so much so that they cannot accept anyone who's kind of like thinking like, well, let me kind of think about all this before I go out and try to produce a million widgets. Let me I want to philosophize. I want to contemplate. I want to meditate. No. They see that they would call it in China counter-revolutionary, counter-revolutionary, insubordination, dangerous intransigence, anti-authoritarian, anarchic, an anarchist, like you would be seen as an anarchist if you don't get with the program. Get with the program. Now, the post-war of 1940, post-war, was actually the time when the ETs really began to press their agenda here, and we had this incredible boom of the military-industrial complex, which Dwight D. Eisenhower, or Ike, as those who liked Ike would say, warned us. He said, the greatest threat to this world is from the military-industrial complex, because the military-industrial complex was in contact with the extraterrestrials, and they were working, they were working together, and the ETs were sharing technology with the military-industrial complex. And so it was very much a button-down corporate situation. Everybody was getting with it because we felt, hey, this is the future. And then my generation came in, and we're all these hippies. And we're all these people who says, no. We're not going to go along with this program at all, okay? And we're going to go turn our attention to the saints and the sages and the gurus and the avatars, and we're going to mine the world for wisdom. We were wisdom miners. That's what I've done my whole life, mining wisdom, mining truth. We weren't interested in producing widgets, at least some of us. I was at the tail end of the baby boomers. And then after my time, a lot of people kind of got back into the let's follow the ET thing because they're going to give us all these really neat gadgets. But there was a time when those generation of people said, hey, we're not going to go along with this corporate military industrial complex corporation, which is really a front for the ETs, actually. And so the result of that is, again, for me, it's going to be freedom, safety and freedom, by being steadfast with this path, being steadfast and not selling out. We called it back then selling out. We called it don't sell out to the man. Don't sell out to the man. That's the worst thing you could do. Don't be a sellout. And of course, eventually we all had to, you know, make a living somehow. But a lot of people, they tried to live off the land, whatever they could do to not sell out to the man, not get pulled, sucked into that military-industrial corporate culture, which is a front for the ETs, is a front for extreme efficiency of means and production and distribution, which is a front for the attempt to solve the problem of existence, when the problem of existence is the imaginary notion of annihilation. And the fact is that annihilation will never take place in reality. So we're simply engaging with a pure speculation with no basis in reality, and it'll never have any basis in reality, which is waste of time, which is meaningless, which is foolish, which is folly, which is whimsical, and has zero necessity to it. So that is what the ETs don't understand. And so they don't know what I'm talking about. Now, to the extent that those people have been sucked into the ET black hole, they don't understand what I'm saying. They don't. And to the extent that one has been able to see through it and working really hard to say, no, that's not what I want, certainly there will be understanding of what's being said here. There will be sympathy, empathy, insight, intuition, and some gist to get the gist of it, of what's being said. There's no question about that. Because the picture is being painted is exactly what has happened over these times. And the boiling point is coming up. The time for the ETs to somehow begin to make their move is here. It is here. And also it's time for us to make our move, as it were. Now, the snapping point, I don't believe, is going to be reached right away. I don't know how much time it's going to take. I really don't. I can't speculate. I just have a vague notion, but it's too speculative at this point. But the thing is, don't panic, don't worry. As events unfold, just continue to go with what you know is where the truth is, which is reality is true and always will be true, and go towards accepting reality as it is, which frees you from the authority of this dream. The authority of this dream is nonsense. It's whimsical. It's ridiculous. It's very audacious, isn't it, to try to tell us that we're bound by this hypothetical. This hypothetical is completely audacious, which sets us back, which is why I always say we need a big boost, because it is so audacious. I can never believe, how in the world can I be treated like this? Who in their right mind would treat me like this or treat you like this? That is absolutely crazy. Don't they know who we are? Doesn't this dream know who we are? And the answer is no. But because it is viewing us as it believes we're going to be, and it believes this is in our best interest, because it believes we're going to face annihilation at some point, and we need to solve this problem. So it doesn't really see us as we are. It does not. Because that annihilation will never happen. So believing it will is not seeing us as we are. Because as we are will always be as we are right now. Reality, the way reality is, will always be the way that reality is. As far as its invulnerability is concerned, there's no threat to reality ever. So what we are now is that we are completely invulnerable. There's no way we can be threatened. And the dream says that's not true. We're going to be threatened, and in fact, we're going to be facing annihilation. So it's not seeing us as we are. The dream does not see us as we are, which is why it treats us so heinously, absolutely, contemptuously. And that's a shocker, isn't it? That we can be treated. I mean, I know, I'm sure humanity's not expecting to be culled and massive culling taking place. That just doesn't happen. Well, it happened in Nazi Germany, didn't it? Happened in the Soviet Union. Happened in Communist China. Happened in Kampuchea, Cambodia. It's happened in Rwanda. It has happened quite a few places, actually, where humanity snaps and starts the culling of certain groups. Starts just the Armenian genocide, which Turkey disputes, but certainly it was a very nasty situation, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so we just don't expect it. It just like blows our mind. People still can't understand what the Germans were thinking, really. When I've looked at that situation extensively my whole life, because I felt just so appalled by it. I remember as a very young, very second grade or third grader, I found out about it, and I was just absolutely appalled. I said, how could that happen? How could that possibly happen? And I've been studying it ever since, trying to understand what in the world, what happened, you know. It's crazy. So we don't expect it. But if you study, you see, For one thing, what happened was that the certain Germans were under the influence of the malevolent ETs, is what happened actually. And they began to worship efficiency and productivity, and they got carried away, and they felt that they needed to create a super state and rule over the whole planet because they were the masters of efficiency of production and attaining results. And they didn't like anybody else standing in the way of that. And you see how they dealt with it very efficiently. Right? They figured out, okay, what's the most efficient, quickest, best way to get rid of whatever is slowing down our efficiency? Cattle, cars, and gas chambers. You know, it was very efficient for them. So we have to realize that these things do happen, but we don't expect it. It'll catch us kind of by surprise. No matter how we prepare, we simply can't wrap our minds around it, really. We really cannot. Very tough. And also, there's another issue, is we expect our fellow citizens to have our backs, especially in America and most countries, really. We expect our fellow citizens to have our backs. I mean, if we get in trouble, we expect our fellow neighbors and citizens to come to our rescue, help us out. And ordinarily, that would be true. You see someone in trouble, what do I need to do to help? Someone car crash or in trouble, hey, what do I need to do to help? You see someone really in trouble, you're going to see what you can do to help. That's human nature. But what I discovered in this foreshadowing is that our fellow citizens and neighbors aren't going to help. They will be so under the spell of the ETs that they're not going to help, and that will catch us very much by surprise. I know there are a lot of people out there who expect like the American military to protect them, who expect the National Guard and police to refuse to imprison them, who expect that martial law can never be declared here because the people, our U.S. citizens, will refuse to comply with illegal laws and decrees, and the fact is that won't happen. They will comply, and that will just blow everyone's mind. It really will be just, they'll catch them off guard entirely. So this event woke me up to this whole situation, because I was in a public place with people around and cars and people pulling in, and the whole situation, the guy did not even pay any attention to it, didn't even care. I realized that in this day and age right now, people are too afraid to get involved. Why? Because the doggone laws about lawsuits is if you do anything to anybody, you're going to get sued. Or you're the one who's going to get in trouble. Like you have people, we've had a lot of court cases here where somebody is feels threatened, and they end up shooting somebody, a policeman. Where if the police do anything, they're automatically sued, they're put on suspension, they go through hell, just because they are trying to deal with a very dangerous situation that they felt that they were in harm's way. Someone was pointing an object at them, might have been a gun, they didn't know. Or there have been situations that got very dangerous and they unfortunately ended badly. And the police are blamed for that. So the police are, there's been a problem with them feeling like, hey, they're targets, that they've been targeted by the legal system, by citizens, that the citizens will sue them and put pressure on them for them to even go to jail for what they do. So police, the whole police forces have been diminished, and we don't have the close connection we used to have with the community. People are afraid to help one another out, thinking that they'll be sued. It's just incredible what's happened. And you hear all these situations of people being attacked, beat up, or stuff happens, and people standing around watching, not doing anything. That's unthinkable in the past. And because there have been too many situations, the media constantly plays up like, oh, somebody did something, and now they're in severe trouble. They're being sued. And there's some big cases right now about people like protecting in neighborhoods who unfortunate situations happen, and they go through hell. I remember the guy at the Olympics in Atlanta was actually a hero, was trying to protect a very volatile situation. He got targeted and went through absolute hell before he finally had to exonerate himself, but he was actually became the suspect. So If you, like if you're a whistleblower, you become the suspect. It's unbelievable. Things have been turned upside down, so people just don't want to get involved. They just don't want to get involved. I was thinking of going to the police and saying, hey, I had this very unsettling experience, and I think there's somebody out here who's a very dangerous person. But what are they going to do? They're going to investigate you, because they don't have the other guy. They don't know where he is. They think, well, who's this guy? You know, and they start investigating you. So people have withdrawn from the whole concept of being their brother's keeper and helping each other out in times of need. This is just doing weird stuff, this video. And that caught me completely off guard. Because I didn't feel any danger. Like I said, well, there's people all around. There's people here. There's cars here. I mean, there's no, I'm not in any danger. How can I be in any danger? Nobody in their right mind would attack me with all these people around, because the people would immediately come to my aid, you know, and they'd break out and be, hey, you know, we're here, and they'd run off. No. Not the case. And that was something that I was had not yet recognized properly. But if you start looking at this, and you start calling up, remembering all these legal situations that have arisen over the years recently, that those who try to protect the public from danger are themselves attacked by misguided, those who are really under the misguidance of the extraterrestrial agenda, actually, who purposefully are trying to cause the civilians refuse to help one another, really. And when you see people being dragged off, like the Germans, they'd come at night and drag people out of their homes, and all the Germans would just sit and just watch, don't do anything. They wouldn't say, hey, wait a minute, this is my neighbor, this is my friend, this is the shopkeeper. I've been going to their shop my whole life. My parents, my grandparents went to their shop. The shop's been there for 200 years, been serving the community this whole time, and now you're dragging off the shopkeeper to execute him? And they should have come out in the streets and protested and gone to the jail. No. Very little of that. It got squashed very quickly. Nobody said anything, hardly. That's the situation the ETs want. They want to be able to come for you in the night and nobody says a word. Next day, oh, they're just missing they got taken in for questioning or whatever or something. I don't know. Let's not talk about it. And just go on with their efficiency of production. Don't want the production line to stop. So the notion that Americans have, that American military, police, and our neighbors, and everybody else is going to stand up to the demands of the ETs to surrender the sovereignty of the U.S., turn in your guns, to basically submit to the New World Agenda, New World Order, martial law, all these things, and the notion that somehow everything's be fine because we won't tolerate, that is a delusion. It's a delusion. And the sooner you wake up from that delusion, the better. It won't be life as normal. It will absolutely not be life as normal anymore. And the idea that none of this can happen because it just doesn't happen in America is simply not true anymore. America is not America it used to be at all. And that's what I experienced too profoundly. I said, holy cow. I mean, I'm afraid to stop and help people now. It's nuts. Or if I see somebody that's just acting nuts, I want to go up to them and say, hey, you're okay? What's going on? No, I mean, you might... they might swing at you and you have to like, whoa, you push them back and they trip and fall and hit themselves and then you're liable manslaughter or something. It is nuts. The whole situation in this country, from a legal standpoint, has been termited and subverted by the legal system here in this country. That's been one of the main efforts by the ETs, to subvert the legal system. And they will continue to subvert it until we're cowed. The public is very cowed and nobody's willing to stick their neck out to help somebody else. When someone does, people applaud because, hey, that's the way it used to be. But then they go back to their shell and say, but I don't want to do that. It's too risky. You get a robber in your house and you cause harm to them, you're liable. You're liable. They trip on something in your house and hurt themselves, they'll sue you for $1 million. It's just, it is a crazy situation that has arisen here. But that's all intentional. It's to cow the population so we don't help one another out. So we don't rise as one and say, not here. And unfortunately, it's been all too successful with that. my computer is acting strange. I'll just keep going. So I'm just drawing the threads out from this ball of yarn. It's like knotted ball, and I'm loosening the knots. Loosening the knots, that's what I do. I'm very good at that simply from long, long practice. And then when you loosen the knots, it's not such a knotty situation. You're able to see, what can take place here? What's necessary to take place? Because the foundation has been very cleverly laid, and I've seen it all taking place, but haven't been able to stop it. It's too entrenched, as Eisenhower said. Hey, this is a very severe threat. Look out. Now some said that. Well, we'll let that go for now. I can go on and on about that. Ronald Reagan said that the greatest threat facing one day the humanity may be united by a threat from outer space, from some space alien. So what kind of information did he have? Well, the fact is humanity won't be united that way. They'll actually, again, the way it's going to go is they will say, wow, welcome to our world. Just like the Indians did to the settlers that came over from Great Britain, mostly, and from Europe. And the Indians said, oh, you know, welcome. How? Welcome. Welcome to our land. Come, sit down. Let us have some squash and some geese, and let's have a feast. And our land is your land. Let us cooperate here. And little did they know that before too long, the settlers are bringing over blankets laced with smallpox. And things got really weird, and suddenly they're being rounded up, put on reservations. Okay? Very few things got totally out of hand. The Indians didn't see that coming. They said, hey, this is our land, is belongs to the Great Spirit. All land belongs to the Great Spirit. There's no ownership of land. So our land belongs to you too. So come on in, and we'll live together and abide together and share this land. And then gradually, and the settlers said, oh, this is great. And then gradually things got super weird, super terrible for the Indians. Same kind of thing with the ETs. They'll come in, we'll say, hey, our world is your world. Welcome, neighbor. Let's be good neighbors. Let's expand our technology. Let's expand into the galaxy. And I'm sure you've got a lot of stuff to help us out with. And we also have a lot of things, our culture, we want to share with you. And let's have a great relationship. This should be wonderful. New world, new world order, one currency. Let's all make it all work here. We're all going to be happy. Let's have a golden age together. And then things will start getting really weird. And I say, whoa, wait a minute. This isn't going the way we thought it would. And before you know it, you're in the re-education camps. Because you didn't respect them enough, meaning you didn't submit to enslavement, to their approval, to their satisfaction. And then the culling, various ways of culling. One of the ways they culled people in World War II is simply stop feeding people. They fed them sawdust. They gave them loaves of bread made of sawdust. Said, we're feeding you. You're getting your bread. Why are you complaining? You're getting your bread? No, it's just sawdust. Maybe they mixed a little flour in with it just to hold the loaf together, but it was sawdust. And they just starved people to death, what they did. And worked them to death, starved them to death, and then bulldozed them into a pit. And so, obviously, that was humanity under the influence of the ETs. Human nature has more regard for itself than to act that way. There has to be very malevolent influences involved that are simply ruthlessly focused on efficiency because they're so afraid of annihilation and they lack spiritual wisdom. They lack the great saviors and sages and saints and avatars, gurus, etc., who have explained that this world is a dream. It's an illusion. It's a mirage. It's a hallucination. It's a hypothetical scenario. And reality is untouched by dreams of its destruction. And there is no threat of annihilation in reality. They're unaware of that. They have not yet been witnessed to. And now, in the situation I was involved in, I tried to turn things to the topic of enlightenment in this situation because he was saying something very strange. And I said, I tried to interpret it in like hey, you sound like you're talking about the headless way, like that's like an enlightenment type of thing, how you view the world, etc. And I got very upset about that. I wasn't able to turn that direction. So it shows me that we think we'll be able to maybe turn the ETs in a spiritual direction. We need to witness to them. We need to witness to them. That's a Christian term, witnessing to people. We need to witness to them. Bear witness to the truth. And that won't work. That won't work. In fact, that'll get them even more angry. Even more angry. That's what really got them angry. Oh, gosh. I tried to just turn things towards wisdom a little bit, and just in a very exploratory way, just a very harmless way, just to see where he was coming from. And no, look out. So we will not be able to witness to the ETs in this situation. Not at this time. Not at this time. They're way too focused on taking this planet over. They're focused on conquest. When someone's focused on conquest, that is not the time to witness to them. It is not. You have to wait to a later time when they realize, wow, this didn't turn out the way we thought. At some point, it's possible to begin to witness to truth to some extent in every world, in every place. But there are other times when conquest is going on, that it is not really possible. And it's stupid. It's better to retreat at that time and wait for the proper opportunity to present itself. And when people become more amenable to listening and considering what is being said. The SS stormtroopers, when they were going through towns and culling the population out of those undesirables they didn't want there, it wasn't any time to talk philosophy. You should not, talk Nietzsche or Schopenhauer or Kant or whatever. It's not the time to get into some sort of discussion about the nature of existence with them. They weren't listening to that. They were all about ruthless efficiency. And so they saw that as just throwing a wrench in their ruthless efficiency. So, you're finished. Just like that. And that is during the times of conquest, that is what happens. So forget about trying to witness to the situation. Forget about your citizens and neighbors rising up and pushing back the conquest. Forget about trying to reason or use human nature or kind-heartedness and all that, just a friendliness, neighborliness, forget about that. None of that stuff is going to work. Not during this phase. So we have to be humble enough to recognize that there are times when you need to retreat. Something that Napoleon didn't understand. We cannot be like Napoleon, thinking that he had some manifest destiny. And that the weather was going to play along with his manifest destiny as he went into Russia. And it did not. In fact, it was a terrible winter. And the Imperial Army got entirely bogged down. And very few people, soldiers, made it out of Russia alive, actually. Completely decimated the army. You don't want to be like that. You don't want to try and advance into a situation when the winter is coming, where a severe winter is coming. You have to know, he thought the winter was going to be a mild one. Well, he was wrong. So you have to know when the winter is going to be mild and when it's going to be severe. What is coming in the world is a severe winter. No question about it, okay? And if you think it's going to be mild, I believe you're going to miscalculate. It's going to be a severe winter, as metaphorically speaking. It is going to be a severe situation in the world. And it's not the time then to trust that everything will go your way, that the citizens will rise up, everybody will say, no, we don't want this, they'll back off, and we will and we'll be able to get along with them, and things won't turn weird, etc., etc., etc. No, that's not going to happen that way. It's a perfect storm. It is a worst-case scenario. It is a Katrina, so to speak. It is a Sandy. It is a Fukushima tsunami. It is a worst-case scenario that's coming up. It is a Gulf oil spill, which was just crazy. It is a worst-case scenario, perfect storm. During those times, you got to know when to get out of Dodge. You got to know when to hold them and know when to fold them. You got to know when to pick up, know when to run, something like that. Kenny Rogers, the gambler. You do have to know that. We have to be good, intuitively aware of the times. Read the room. Read the room, meaning read the world situation. You can do it. Absolutely, you can do it. Many are doing it. What I'm doing is saying it's going to be worse than you expect, and keep reading the room, and don't give up. Don't get lost in details. Don't get lost in details. Get focus on intent. Focus on seeing the big picture. That's all important, because then you can easily see, the indications are there. The pressure is dropping. Boom. The cyclonic, huge mass of moist air, jet streams coming this way, high system here, low here, it's going to push right through here, and you know, all these things, the basic parameters, you say, okay, it's going to rain like cats and dogs in about a day, and the latest storms that came through here in the Bay Area, the meteorologists had it pinned to the minute almost. It was amazing. They said it's going to start raining, stop raining at 4 o'clock, and right at 4 o'clock it stopped, or it's going to start at a certain hour, and it started right then. I mean, they really had it pegged. Very impressive. And but we don't have to peg it exactly when every events are going to happen, exactly when. We do have to get the gist of the situation, that there is this superstorm coming into this world, and we need to get out of Dodge. We got to fold them and run away, as it were. That's okay. You got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them. Know when to something, pick them up or something, and know when to run. I'm not sure, I can't remember the lyrics, but speaking of lyrics, just to throw a little nice little embellishment in here, how important it is to hang in there and continue your efforts. I'll illustrate this by a very interesting situation I just had. I was listening to this song, a pop song from 1963, so it's about, 50 years old, almost, and I've sung it so many times, heard it so many times, and the fact is that there were lyrics in there I couldn't understand. I never understood them, so I just kind of slurred over them, and finally, after 50 years of listening to this song, I decided I'm going to try and look up the lyrics. I just said, gosh darn it, I can't figure them out. I'm going to look them up. I looked them up. I said, oh my gosh, that's what they're saying. And I went back and listened to the song, and it was right. But actually, the first lookup of the lyrics, part of the lyrics, they got it wrong. Whoever posted the lyrics online got it wrong. And I saw another video, karaoke video with the lyrics, and they said, oh, and I said, is that it? Went back and listened to the song very carefully. And they were wrong too. They actually almost got it right, but they were still wrong. So even the lyrics that are posted online, they're still mistaken. But if you make the effort, you will gradually hear what's being said. So just like that, you may have spent a lifetime trying to get it, almost getting the truth, almost understanding, but not quite understanding. But if you make an extra little effort to get it, you may suddenly figure it out. Say, oh my gosh, that's what it is. All this time, it was just that simple. All I had to do was just look in the right place and to figure it out. Because there's probably some part of this whole of enlightenment, of realization, of freedom, of salvation that we don't quite understand. It's a little murky. But if you look into it, it might be solved like that. What was the lyrics? My baby's always the one that does the things he's never done. My baby's always the one. My baby's always the one that's done the things they've never done. Say, my baby's always the one. What is that? My baby's always the one. My baby's always... Huh? What is that? My baby's always the one. It's my baby's always the one. My baby's always the one. They slur it together. My baby's always the one. And I can get around and figure out what are they saying. What are they saying there? And the other one was... he's not a rebel. No, no, no. He's not a rebel. He's not a rebel. No, no, no. He's not a rebel. No, no, no. I can never figure that out. What are they saying? And it's, he's not a rebel. No, no, no. He's not a rebel. No, no, no. So those two parts of that song I could never figure out. My baby's always the one. Actually, at first, when I found out what it was saying, my baby's always the one, I couldn't sing it. I couldn't sing it. And I said, it can't be that because I can't sing it that way. It has to be something else. And then suddenly, I got it linguistically. I was able to get my vocal apparatus to give the right accents to it, and suddenly I was able to sing it. And then I went back and listened, and I said, that is it. That is exactly what it is. The people before heard it, they said, my baby, always the one. No, it's an S there. There's an S there, but you have to sing it right. My baby's always the one, that, like that. So you might have a situation here that's, you almost got it. You almost got it, and you think, well, that can't be it, because I can't quite do that. And then suddenly, you'll be able to do it. Now it's a piece of cake. Although I keep falling back into the old patterns about my misinterpreted lyrics. I always thought it was, why is he always the one that does the things they've never done? That's not it at all. I just kind of made it up because I couldn't figure out what it was. Why is he always the one? My baby's always the one. So you may fall back into old patterns. Like today, I keep saying it the wrong way, then I catch myself saying, no, it's this way. And you just practice a little bit to these new patterns, and then suddenly you'll get it. You'll know how to sing the song, as it were. So don't give up. Don't give up. Because you may be really close, actually. You may have been working a long time, and you're not far off at all. All you have to do is look up the lyrics, and look up the truth. Do a little extra effort. I don't know why it took me 50 years to look it up, because I guess I felt like I should have been able to figure it out. I don't know. And I just finally said, wow, 50 years. Just didn't want to look it up. Of course, back then, they didn't publish the lyrics, I think, in 63, so we didn't have the internet, so I didn't know how to look it up, tell you the truth. But since the internet came out, I guess there's ways to look up lyrics, because most lyrics are posted online. And there's a lot of songs I couldn't figure out the lyrics to, and I look up the lyrics. But this one, for some reason, I just wouldn't do it. So hang in there. Don't give up. Don't give up. Could be closer than you think. Closer than you know. Suddenly you're singing the song. Like, perfect. Wow. And you're a rebel. You see, from the standpoint of the ETs, you're a rebel. You are. Absolutely are. I'm a rebel. From their standards. Because I won't kowtow to them. I won't be a sycophant. I won't give up my wisdom, my knowledge for them. Stoke their ego, thinking that they know it all, and how can I be expressing something that they don't know? It must be crazy, because you know, the thing, if it's not in the yellow pages, it doesn't exist. Well, if the ETs, if they don't already know it, then it must not be true at all. They think they know it all. I actually had correspondence with an ET, one who was either channeling an ET or was an ET. It was hard to say, but truly, that was an ET. There's no question about it. I vetted it very carefully, and I asked them questions, and they simply had no knowledge about some of the great spiritual teachers and spiritual teaching at all, and they just dismissed it as just as nothing. They said, that is not part of our knowledge, and it is not legitimate knowledge. In other words, they believe that what they know is legitimate knowledge, and if you know something other than that, it's illegitimate knowledge. It's not, and you need to be re-educated out of that. So that was scary. That was scary. I said, holy cow. They do not have regard and respect for our great teachers. They really don't. And they think they're above that. They're above that. These fourth dimensional knuckleheads, you know. They don't understand that we've had perfect teachers on this planet. For them, now 4D, that's it. That's it. They're like sophomores in high school who think they know everything over the incoming freshmen, whereas the incoming freshman says, hey, you know, we know some stuff too. We're not that stupid, you know. And then the sophomore says, oh, you don't know anything. Or the seniors over the freshmen, I don't know. But you get that notion. Usually it's the sophomores. People are acting very sophomoric because now they realize we're not freshmen anymore. So, you know, we're vastly superior to the incoming freshmen. Nah, not true, not true. I used to beat the upperclassmen and all sorts of stuff, and they just ignored it. They completely ignored it, like I didn't have any capacity whatsoever. As the ETs, they say, "No, you don't have any wisdom here in this world. You're knuckleheads here. You're all stupid. We're here to save you, to help you learn how to do things better, solve problems better. Because look, you obviously can't solve your own problems." And of course, What the ETs have brought here, this planet, and inculcated here with all their science and technology, is what's causing most of the problems. I mean, you know, just it's ridiculous. It is ridiculous. The population explosion, which is killing the planet, was brought about by the Green Revolution, which is brought about by petrochemical fertilizers, which is and brought on and genetically modified seeds, is being used all over the world to get higher harvests, to get to feed more people. So, I mean, the whole population thing is a completely unnatural situation brought about by science and technology that was largely seeded here by the extraterrestrials. Most of the stuff we have was seeded here by that. They have ways to do that. They can telepathically contact certain scientists. They use telepathy. And they can implant telepathically, download, as it were, into, we're aware of like downloading from a server wireless. We can do wireless downloads. I'm doing this taping wirelessly. Okay, so it's wirelessly going to a modem that goes to a server, which is going to your place, which probably you're watching it wirelessly too. So the ETs simply wirelessly download information into various scientists and various people's brains so that they suddenly see, oh, I see how to do this. I know how to do this. That kind of thing. And then they invent all sorts of stuff and get into all sorts of mischief, which they have been doing nonstop to an extreme extent and creating massive, massive problems. People are smarter, generally, than to ruin their own ecosystem, ruin their own world. Human beings generally are not into that. Some are kind of stupid when they get caught up in the notion of greed, profit, and materialism, etc. But, for instance, the Indians were very wise about, hey, don't ruin our ecosystem. They're very wise about that, actually. In our generation, we actually grew up admiring the American Indians. We tried to emulate them in our dress and our hairstyles, and a lot of stuff we did was actually rebelling against the corporate culture of the day, which is being very destructive to the environment, and emulating the Indians, saying because they were very aware of ecology and not destroying their land. They took what they needed. That's it. They just took what they needed. They didn't go out hunt for sport and kill animals for sport. They didn't cut down trees just to build mansions and stuff. Now they realized, hey, this is an ecosystem. We've been living here for a long time. Respect the dynamics here. And so we understood that and respected it. So we would say, hey, let's just because we can do something doesn't mean we should do it. The wisdom is often known, but not by what it does or what it doesn't do, what it refrains from doing. That is more important. And certainly there are many, many, many things in the world we should have refrained from doing. But again, the push from the ETs was so strong into this world, so strong, because they want this planet for their own, because they ruined their own planet, probably destroyed it. They're very destructive to planets. They want the resources. They want this planet. Absolutely, they want it. And they view us as squatters here. They don't view us as this is our planet. They only view it legitimately at all. Not at all. And just like the European settlers gave smallpox blankets to the Indians as the Indians became troublesome, they said, hey, you know, these wars are getting real pain. Isn't there a better way? Oh, sure, give them smallpox. And that worked really good. The same thing the ETs, when there's problems with martial law and resistance and all this stuff, and they'll say, hey, there's got to be a better way. And that's when they'll start unleashing biotechnology on the planet. Certain viruses, recombinant viruses like H5N1, stuff like that. Bird flu viruses that they've custom tweaked to be highly transmissible. And of course, only those who, the sycophants who have submitted to the ETs are going to get the right inoculations for those type of things. There'll be inoculations, but only those who play willing to play the game and submit and be enslaved will get the inoculations. The rest of people won't get them. There will also be all sorts of problems, not meant Earth changes. I mean, there will be dynamics with the Earth occurring for sure, but that gets into another whole chapter of the story, as it were. Bottom line is, it is a time to get out of Dodge. It's a time to fold them. Don't hold them. Fold them. Fold the cards. If you're holding a bad hand, fold them. If we're holding a bad hand, We got nothing in our hand. Sometimes you get a bad hand. Doesn't mean you're bad, doesn't mean you're incompetent, anything like that. No, it's just the way that the universe works. This whole hypothetical scenario will deal you a bad hand. Really bad sometimes. Ultimately, all hands are meaningless. And the wisdom that I've been able to get to is to see everything in existence as equally meaningless. And not to draw any judgment, differentiation at all here. That is the goal of A Course in Miracles, is to not differentiate at all among dreams. Not differentiating at all among dreams. Because Jesus said, what good is it to differentiate among illusions? How can you translate that into reality? What utility does it have in reality? It's absolutely none. None. What use does it have? None. What meaning does it have? None. Absolutely none. And there is no meaning to it. There's no meaning to it. Dreams have nothing to do with reality. So why differentiate among dreams? Why differentiate among illusions, or mirages? Mirage is still a mirage. You're differentiating, well, this mirage has a mirage of a castle, this one's a city, this one's a landscape. That's all mirage. You're wasting time differentiating. Why differentiate among different ways to try to solve the problem of annihilation when the problem of annihilation is a non-problem? It will never arise. It's stupid. It's crazy. So being able to just recognize that we don't need to judge existence at all. That's the final judgment, is to realize we don't need to judge it. That is the final judgment. And that's the goal. The goal is to recognize we don't need to judge existence at all. It's all equally meaningless, the good and the bad and the ugly. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. Equally futile. Zero. They're all zero. So why are we spending time trying to differentiate? That is what's called ignorance. And ignorance is not bliss at all. So, ignorance is enslavement. So we don't want to be enslaved. We don't want to be ignorant. We want to gravitate towards sidestepping the situation. We want to gravitate towards folding our hands. Say, hey, this is not a good hand. This is a lousy hand. I'm going to fold this hand. I'm not going to play it. I'm going to fold it. A wise gambler says, this is a terrible hand. I'm not going to put all my chips on the table with this hand. I'm going to fold the hand, and I'll wait for the next deal. Like that. That is what we need to do. Fold our hand. And that doesn't mean we're going to be annihilated or anything like that. No, there are contingencies for those who want to fold their hands. Hey, we're going to sit this hand out. We're going to sit this hand out. We don't have anything. Let's get up from the table and go into some other place, either where the card table, everybody's playing. We get up from our seats. Ah, I fold. Get up, walk away, get some refreshments or something. Go outside. Take a walk. Whatever, get away from the card table. That's what we can do. It seems to me, I will be doing that. The way things seem to be developing is I will be doing that. That's what I've aimed for. And I've been given indications that there will be some type of sequestering, some type of protection, and I don't really know how it's going to go. That's been left obscure because I guess that's they don't want to open it up too much at this point. There will be ways. Like the Underground Railroad didn't publish the, you know, in the paper. How is it working? It gets passed along through underground channels, as it were. People pass it along to their friends. Say, hey, there's a way. You know, there's a way. That let's get to freedom. So what's important is not just conceptually talk about it, but just actually do it. So there actually is help. Literal help, not just conceptual talking. At this point, we're still talking, but at some point, we have to walk the walk, too. And people will start saying, whoa, this is getting too weird. Well, let's get out of here. Just like that situation I had yesterday. I said, whoa, this is absolutely a dangerous, weird, very dangerous situation, and it could lead to death, annihilation here. So let me get out of here right now. Let's not wait. Let's not hang around. Let's not make any more small talk. Obviously, this small talk isn't working. It's not working. Time to get out. So these videos are helping you get ready for that time when you will have that epiphany and say, whoa, what I thought would work isn't working. And then you'll remember, okay, yeah, I prepared for this time. I kind of was at least partially aware. it'll still catch you by surprise. Like I was caught by surprise there. Several factors caught me by surprise. Hometown, I think this can't happen in my hometown. That's another thing. I said, this is my hometown. It can't happen. Something like this can't happen here. There are people around. They have my back. No. The police will help out. No, not necessarily. This person is somebody just like me, very similar to me. It's just a neighbor. No, the neighborly thing. No. Nothing arose that I expected to. So I was caught a little bit. Wow. Plus, I needed to complete this work. I shouldn't have done that. I should have just got out of there right away. All these things, duty to production. We have this duty. We feel we need to continue to produce here. And no, we don't. No, we don't. No, we don't. No, we don't. We don't have to fix any problems of existence because reality has no problems. And this is just a supposed foreshadowing of the problems that reality is going to have, and it's just a made-up, hypothetical, nonsensical delusion. And yet, very audacious one, because the mind is producing it, and the mind is all-powerful, all-creative in terms of producing and presenting, experiencing. So it is a very audacious presentation. We look at like stage presentations that they just all this razzle dazzle, and we look at it and say, wow, that's incredible. How are they doing this amazing presentation with so many people and dancing and stage settings and lighting? And wow, it's audacious. Well, just look at the universe, how audacious the universe is and how it's being presented. That's really audacious. That's the mind. That's our mind at work. And it's putting on a really big show. Very audacious, telling us that we need to submit to this purpose and keep working on annihilation. And we just say, no, 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 we're choosing a new idea, mind, and you're going to serve that idea. And of course, mind will. Mind is not rogue. It is just serving the idea that we chose to be prime creator, just serving that idea, presenting a way to deal with that situation, try to get that situation. And it says, well, hey, if you do that, reality will be annihilated. You'll be annihilated. So you better find out a way to survive annihilation, and then you can figure out a way to be prime creator. So as you go forward and you run into situations, you start seeing more red flags, you're going to start saying, hey, this thing is not going the way. And then you'll think, part of you will have the courage to leave, to sidestep it. Because just like I did, I had something there. I had something. I had some kind of confidence. I was in good shape. But that's why I say people do not ignore the condition you're in, as far as fitness and diet, etc. Because actually that day I was feeling really fit and on my feet and strong and full of confidence. I really was feeling great. Best I felt in a long, long time, actually. And that really helped me. I wasn't feeling exhausted, sluggish, tired. I said, hey, I mean, I felt on the ball. So I was hopping around, moving fast. And I got out of there fast, very smoothly. And just the very fact I was projecting someone who's very balanced, my balance and the way I was moving everything, my body language, I kept a sense of confidence the whole time in myself, along with a sense of integrity and not consenting to any harm. So there's a whole package there. The whole package got me through. The whole package got me out of there. So I'm saying, don't ignore part of the package. Don't be balanced. Be integrated with the whole package. Have it all. Have it all. Now, interestingly, to segue into another little vignette here, they always say the last 5 pounds are the hardest, and that is very true. I lost 15 pounds, and then the last five I just couldn't get. I kept going down, up, down. Oh my gosh, I said I was not going to get it. And then I got this push. I got a boost, a little boost, and something got my attention. It was a very small little thing, and this is important to use expedience in your experience. Attention getters. Whatever is an attention getter, pay attention to it. What happened to me was I was in the yard, and there was this soda pop can, this aluminum can, in a place where you absolutely should not be. There's no way for it to get there. I said, I didn't put that there. Nobody here drinks this. What is it? What is this? Where'd it come from? I couldn't figure out. No way it could have gotten there. It's bizarre, absolutely bizarre. I said, you know what, I'm going to open up that soda can. It was all crushed. I'm going to see what it says on the soda can. Because this is a real intention getter. I am really intrigued. Why is this soda can suddenly sitting in a place it absolutely should not be? I opened it up and it was a grapefruit drink. And suddenly I said, whoa, I need to start drinking grapefruit juice. I've just been thinking about grapefruit juice and maybe going, integrating that into my diet. I suddenly said, I'm going to do it. I'm going to start grapefruit juice. It clicked, something clicked. And I went down and got grapefruit juice, and I started drinking that. And then suddenly I said, you know what I need to do? I need to go on a fruit diet. And I suddenly decided I'm going to go for it. I haven't eaten fruit in a long time. Years and years and years I've not eaten hardly any fruit. And suddenly I decided I'm going to start eating fruit. Started doing that. And over a space of, I don't know, how long has it been? 5 days? I have dropped 5 pounds. I've got, or more. It's unbelievable. The pounds have just completely dropped off, just super fast. I've dropped 5 or 6 pounds in 5 or 6 days. I'd say averaging a pound a day, where I was not able to do that at all before. I was just stuck on this plateau, even though I was hardly eating anything at all. Really, I couldn't lose any more weight. And this diet, the weight just vanished. Like in one day, I dropped 3 pounds in one day. It was unbelievable. So, it worked. It worked because I kind of paid attention. As you go in your life, pay attention to stuff that's like really anomalous, that gets your attention. Like, what in the world? You know, why is that? It's really strange to me. What is that? Pay attention to that. Then turn it into an expedient. Turn it into a means to make a good decision and to motivate yourself to do something that you that's super helpful for you. So I was supposed to be, by Christmas, I wanted to be a certain weight. I've already made that weight. way ahead of time. That just blows my mind. I didn't think I'd make it. There was a time there I didn't think there's no way in the world would I make this weight by Christmas. It's not going to happen. And now I've already made it and I'm below it. Below it. And wow, that is a big push. So it goes to show that you, if you pay attention, you can get some help in the most oddest of ways, really. Very odd way. Because you are willing to pay attention. And people think the grace of God, how's it happen to you? In very clever ways, anomalous ways, attention-getting ways that most other people would not notice at all. It would be meaningless to them. Absolutely meaningless. But to me, I had been thinking about the whole issue of what do I need to do. I need to go on some other kind of diet and thinking about grapefruit juice. And then I saw the grapefruit can in a totally anomalous situation. I said, you know what? I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. It sort of triggered this willingness to do it. And things like that happen all the time if you're aware. We say we make prayers and then we wonder why God doesn't answer our prayers. God answers our prayers, but in ways that we not recognize. We're expecting Him to whisper in our ear or something, I don't know what, but it's usually ways that are quite amazing. We think, that just may be a coincidence. Ah, no way. No, the world works in very, God's grace works in very mysterious ways, actually. And sometimes we can take it too far by looking for signs everywhere, and you get lost in signs or numerology or something. Everything, it can be taken too far. You have to correlate it with your motivation and see if it's really triggering a great deal of help for you or not. And don't get carried away with it. But still, during the daytime, work, practice. Today, I practice saying, I accept reality just as it is. I'm willing to accept reality right now as it is. Reality as it is right now. The way it's always been, the way it's always will be, and the way it is right now. I'm willing to accept that. And all day long I was working on that basic statement throughout the day. Try not to listen to the radio, try not to do anything. Just as you go about your work, trying to work on that statement. But again, that's not going to stop the scenario from unfolding in this world, in this planet, because this planet has consented to it. That's the problem. They've consented, and they've given so much consent, they're not likely to withdraw the consent. Even if Jesus arrived with all the angels, they're not going to withdraw their consent. They've gone too far down the rabbit hole already. They've invested too strongly in it. They're not going to just dump all their stock in it and take a loss on it. Just write it off as all as a loss. No. That's why it was super important not to get invested in it in the first place. Very important. You cannot invest heavily in pursuing solutions to annihilation, this hypothetical scenario, and investing in a new cycle, and then at the last minute just write it off, say, no, forget it all. Doesn't work that way. If you have been struggling against it and deciding, I don't really want to invest in it, how do I disinvest without losing it all, et cetera, keep working on that. And what I have seen is that what we'll get is that it's way better in this world, actually, way better situation. So you're not going to really lose anything, you're going to gain. And of course, everything you hold on in this world is going to be taken away from you anyway, especially if you die. You're not going to have anything here, as it were. Can't take it with you. So even as things get bad, you can, if you've been working in the right direction, you can suddenly come across a point and say, okay, I feel like I made a decision. I'm going to write this off as just a wasted time. My investment in this new cycle is wasted time. And again, these will seem to come with all sorts of solutions to all our problems. And we'll think, wow, these guys are really helpful. These guys are really great. And then it'll start turning really weird and then really dangerous. And then for those who stay, really deadly. So don't be fooled by all this. I don't want to buy ETs bearing gifts, as it were. Because we will start to annoy them. They'll get annoyed by us. And then that annoyance will turn into rage, and they'll feel insulted by us. They're very easily insulted. Very easily insulted. They seem very nice and cordial and talkative, but super easily insulted. And somehow they don't get over it. They want a resolution to it. They demand a resolution to it, that you must apologize for insulting them, and you must agree to not do it again. Really, that's how they act. I know exactly how the ETs will act. I've already been through it. And they will demand an apology, and then demand that you pledge you'll never do it again. And if you do it again, then they will demand harsh penalties on you. Very harsh. They're very draconian in that way. And they don't think so. They think, why would anyone want to insult me? It must have been intentional, and it should be punished harshly, because in this galaxy, we should all get along and not insult one another. Yeah, but part of getting along is recognizing that you may have your feelings hurt, and you may feel insulted, and you just have to brush it off and say, hey, that's part of the situation here in this hypothetical scenario. You know, forgive, love, forgive. Recognize that we all have different perspectives, and they're not going to always match up, and sometimes what someone says may seem insulting. They didn't intend it that way at all. Not at all. So we should not be easily insulted. In fact, attack is never justified. Never justified. It's cold out here. It's going to get very cold in the world, as it were. So, getting out of Dodge. Let's get back to getting out of Dodge. I'm working hard at it, very hard at it, because the more people that do it, pave the way, the better the road is, right? If you get a road that's paved, a lot can take it. If you get the ice is broken, a lot of ships can go. If you have an icebreaker going through the harbor, breaking the ice, then a lot of ships can follow. So it's important for people, those who can do it, to do it. Very important. But again, people expect us to submit to this new cycle. So if you say you're going to do something else, they say, you're crazy, what are you doing? You're nuts. That's not easy. Because it seems like this new cycle is the cycle of solving all problems. We don't recognize, though, as we're busy solving some problems, we don't see the terrible problems sneaking up on us, even worse problems sneaking up on us. We'll say, the ETs are here to help us heal the ozone, to help us get rid of the fluorocarbons, and they'll help us predict earthquakes and tsunamis. They'll help us cure illnesses, cure cancer. If the ETs say, we'll cure breast cancer, we know how to cure breast cancer. Come on in. Are you kidding? Come on in. So, of course, they're going to offer these lost leaders, these marketing devices that people will say, come on in. Glad you're here. Where have you been all our lives? And as they're focused on all the so-called good stuff that the ETs are doing, they won't be caught off guard by the gathering weirdness of it. Or the ETs are feeling very insulted by us. And they will. They'll feel like humans are extremely disrespectful. Extremely disrespectful. And for us, we won't see that at all. We're not being disrespectful. We're being very kind and hospitable. But they will see we're being incredibly disrespectful. That's when the problems will suddenly become very intense. And the snapping point, it will start being brewing. A snapping point, we'll see, is starting to brew. And then you know, wow. So, keep this in mind. Be educated, be familiarized with this narrative. It's the best I can do at this point. I'm trying to give it all out here without... I don't need to step on too many toes. I mean, I've said enough in other videos too. We don't have to detail how it's all going to take place. Because that's not important. What's important is knowing when to fold them. When to fold the car. Say, hey, let's gravitate. Let's just say, I accept the path of gravitating towards accepting reality as it is. That's like a mantra. I accept the path of gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. Right now, I accept the path of gravitating towards the acceptance of reality as it is right now. Again, right now, I accept the path of gravitating towards the acceptance of reality as it is right now. That's like a mantra. You can use that mantra. Right now, I accept the path of gravitating towards the acceptance of reality as it is right now. Because right, it's always right now, and reality always is what it is. So it is what it is right now. You can accept it right now. It's always that. Now, there's some teachings in this world that talk about nowness. Various teachings. A lot of teachers talk about nowness. But some of it, and maybe a lot of it, is actually talking about the nowness in time, of the nowness of existence. This is a completely different, something totally different than the nowness, accepting reality as it is right now. Totally different. Apples and oranges, completely different. And I'm not saying accept existence as it is right now. Not at all. I'm saying accept reality as it is. Existence is not reality. It's a hypothetical scenario. It's a dream. It's a dream of vulnerability, of annihilation, when there's no such reality, no factual basis to that whatsoever in reality. None. So accepting reality as it is right now, which is often called mindfulness, is literally a training for greater efficiency. And all this talk about loving relationships, etc., again, that also is based on existence, and that is the purpose of that is to have more cooperative civilization so we can work together to solve problems and work more efficiently and productively towards solving this problem of annihilation. It has nothing to do with enlightenment, our salvation, or accepting reality as it is. Not at all. It's not like that. You see the great gurus, take Ramana Maharshi, and the people came to see him. He would just sit there very quietly, abiding in the overlay, accepting reality as it is. And the kind of feeling people had is very different than the feeling when people are talking about now about loving relationships. We kind of, oh, you're so beautiful, so wonderful, let me hug you, let me hug you, I love you forever, you're so lovable, thank you, so beautiful. And it's different. Or the mindfulness of, yes, I'm aware of the rain right now. I'm aware of the sounds. I'm aware of the atmosphere. I'm aware of my breathing. I'm aware of my body. I'm aware of everything happening in my body. I'm aware of my energy. You know, that's mindfulness meditations about existence. And these loving relationships are relationships about people. People. Existence. People are imaginary figures. We're not people in reality. We're spirit. And the way spirit shows love is to abide in, accept reality as it is, and to testify and bear witness to that. Because that's what saves. That's all that saves. Ultimately, we all have to do, accept reality as it is. That's the only way. There's only one way to salvation, that is to accept reality as it is. How we get to that point of acceptance is different for all of us. So we respect the differences as far as the path goes. But the goal, there's only one goal. There's not multiple goals, there's only one goal. And the mindfulness meditation about be aware of our body, get into our bodies, and have loving personal relationships with people, and have this dwell in the now of existence, where everything, where we're heightened awareness of so-called the beauty of nature and the beauty of things, because we're just focused right on now. That's not what was being talked about here at all. It's the opposite. The nowness of reality means accepting reality as it is, because it's always the way that it is. It's not going to ever change, and it never has changed. So it's like the eternal now. If you want to talk in conceptual time-based terms, it's the eternal nowness of reality is the nowness we're talking about. Except the eternal nowness of reality, that it is untouched by dreams of change, or dreams of problems, or dreams of annihilation. Completely untouched, and it always is the way that it is. Always. That's the nowness, the eternal nowness that we are gravitating towards accepting. And the loving relationships is to bear witness to this truth, that we've accepted reality as it is. That is true love. And then, because we realize that everyone, all aspects of spirit, are equally unthreatened by this dream of annihilation. And we see everybody as they really are, which is spirit and not body. We don't see him as body. And Nanda Maima said she didn't see anybody as a body. She saw him as spirit. And to her, it was symbolized by this beautiful, beautiful, glowing white light or something. She said that's how she saw everybody. But ultimately, it's even beyond any symbol of energy. It is spirit. It is essence, beyond perception. Simply that which is directly, inherently experienceable, which is reality. So that's loving relationship, is seeing the one true relationship of reality, which all encompasses. The overlay encompasses all aspects of spirit. The whole dream scenario encompasses all of it. It's not loving relationships, plural. It's loving relationship, singular. There's only one relationship. That's it, which is a relationship with truth, with reality, with itself. Is the one relationship there is, the only one. And as far as practicing mindfulness, I'd say practice looking for expedience and anomalies and attention getters, and being aware of those, and that those help trigger deep insight into that are very helpful for you. Don't get too distracted. Be aware of your surroundings. That is beneficial, but not an end in itself. And you don't have to get into your body. I never focus on my body. What am I feeling? Oh, my breath, energy. I never focus on that at all. I pay no attention to it, really. So it's when you forget about your body, you're much better able to view things abstractly. View things abstractly and see on the level of consent. See on the level of accepting reality as it is. You can get it clarified, getting close to that level, when you really are not even thinking about your body whatsoever or your surroundings. What I'm talking here is pretty much like I'm not even aware of my surroundings at all. Not aware of my body, not aware of my surroundings. Just vaguely in the background, but there's like 1% attention there or something. So that's what's really important. Focus on what's important. So we're going forward now. 2 weeks left towards the most famous milestone in history, really. The end of the Mayan long count calendar, and what many people think is going to be sort of a tipping point, and it's looking that way. It could be a subtle tipping point. Maybe things will get up in the morning, everything will seem exactly the same, but the tipping point will have been reached, where the world simply tips over, as it were. Some people expect a literal tipping over. That could happen too. That could happen. There could be a crustal shift, pole shift, as it were, where the crust shift. That's possible. That's possible. It's happened before, supposedly. There have been a lot of weird stuff's happened to this world history. A lot of very weird stuff. We don't have to worry about that, though, because we're concerned about right now getting out of Dodge, folding the cards, our hand, right? We got a bad hand. Bad hand has been dealt. Existence dealt us a very bad hand, which is what it does. It deals crises to us. Except this time, we're going to deal with the crises differently. We're going to decide to accept the path of accepting reality as it is. And that's a whole different ballgame. That's a miraculous path. According to the world existence, it will seem miraculous, absolutely miraculous. And people will just say, well, we don't know how to relate to that. It's just miraculous. We don't know what to say. And then most will just deny it, ignore it, and they go on in their march in history. They say it never happened. It's just myth that it happened. They say the Incas disappeared. I don't know what happened to the Incas. Maybe they went underground in some underground cities or something, or who knows? They shifted dimensions, something like that. Or people, but now people say, no. They say they just starved to death, or they ran out of water, the food, or some kind of, you know, some scientific explanation for it. Or maybe they did disappear. Maybe they did. Maybe we can do a similar thing, actually. But of course, as history goes along, people will change it, and revisionism is always in play in existence. Revisionism is the order of the day, the soup du jour. Of course they're going to revise anything that does not fit into their paradigm and does not fit along with their agenda. They will revise it and say, well, this is what it really happened, and the other stuff is just a myth, just a superstition. Like the catastrophes on the planet that have happened many times. They say, no, never happened, never happened, never happened. And how do you explain all these extreme anomalies in the world, which I've studied to a very great length? And you can't explain them other than some very, very weird stuff happening to the planet. Possible stoppage of the Earth's rotation. Possible crustal shift. Possible pole shift. Planet turning over on its axis, so to speak. Huge tsunamis. Massive tsunamis and just crazy stuff. Supposedly there was an ice dam in an ice age where the Earth started heating up and massive amount of ice was melting, and yet there was a dam that built up, and behind this there was just like an ocean of water. And at some point the dam finally collapsed and this ocean of water just came pouring across the land. And there was this great flood from that. That's possible. There's also possible of massive collapses of gas pockets under the ocean, sudden collapses where the world is honeycombed with these gas pockets. Enough like methane gas escapes, or these gas pockets escape or something. They empty out and they somehow suddenly collapse. That could cause just an incredible tsunami, gigantic tsunami. Go just beyond it. All sorts of bizarre stuff have happened on this planet, and this could certainly happen again. Probably they will at some point. But more importantly than that, it is getting out of Dodge before the snapping point is reached on this planet. Now, will those things happen December 21st? I don't know. I don't necessarily see it happening. It could be just a day like any other. It could be just, and we think, nothing happened. But, again, subtly something really has happened. And the crystallization of consent on this planet crystallizes to such an extent that you suddenly feel like an outsider. You suddenly say, whoa, I really don't belong here anymore. You may have an epiphany. He said, I really don't belong here anymore. This is not my home anymore. And it's not. This world is literally not our home anymore. Already. I feel that very clearly. It's not our home. It has ceased to be our home. It has changed that much. It has changed that much already. And maybe by December 21st, we'll realize it. That this world is no longer our home. We're being seen as squatters here. We're being treated as if we're squatters. Obviously, if we're being treated as squatters, and that's how it's going to go, it's not our home anymore. And indeed, we're all squatters in existence, aren't we? It's just the ETs don't understand that, but we can be wise enough to realize we are squatters here. Don't argue with facts. The only thing is the ETs are squatters too. In fact, this whole existence is we're just squatters because it's not our home at all. It's a hypothetical scenario based on trying to figure a way to survive annihilation. So we're just squatting here in this rundown, dilapidated place we call existence, which is just terrible. And these are saying, doing us a favor, actually. They're doing us a favor by saying, hey, you're all squatters. We can say, yeah, you know what? You're right. See you later. We're going back to our home. Why not? Why not? Don't get mad at the EDs. Just say, okay, thank you very much. Yeah, we're going to leave and go to our true home. Of course, they'll say, whoa, you got to pay us for squatting here for so long. You got a debt to pay. No, we don't. How can we incur a debt to reality? And how can a hypothetical demand a true debt? It can only be a hypothetical debt. And the payment can only be a hypothetical payment. And the whole thing is a ridiculous farce in the first place. So we don't owe any debt at all. And the squatters will say, okay, we'll go home. Time to go home. Yeah. I wish I would like to have the audacity to just really push this out into the world. I've tried in the past to do very audacious stuff, really, and it hasn't turned out very well. That's the truth. I've done some really audacious stuff. Holy cow. Just, which was very well intentioned, etc., but it doesn't float. It doesn't fly in this world anymore. It really doesn't fly. I saw someone that had this billboard, sandwich board or something, walking around in town saying Christ is coming soon or something like that. And I gave him a thumbs up because it's true. But I said, wow, the audacity of this man, elderly man like my age, to do that. I'm sure the police picked him up at some point. You know, what are you doing? You know, you're crazy. You need to be evaluated psychiatrically or something. How come you're not being productive? What's wrong with your life? And he didn't get any results. It just doesn't fly. It doesn't fly. My generation was a very audacious generation. We dropped out, and we rejected the corporate culture, and we did back to the land, and we did all sorts of stuff. It was really audacious. We just hitchhiked around the world. We just went to different cultures. We learned different teachings all over the planet, and wow. Just so many audacious things we really did. But that doesn't fly so well anymore. It really, really doesn't. We're so buttoned down right now. So buttoned down. That people, if you start doing some audacious thing, they'll think you're absolutely nuts. I'm capable of doing it. But I don't see anyone in the world really that is really doing it now so much. Not really. There's not a groundswell of that stuff going on. So, you know, a movement of one is not a movement. It isn't. You may think, I say, oh, I'm being audacious. I'm really bringing the truth. And there's a movement here. No, it's not. It's not. If you're a soul player, you don't have a band. You're singing, you're doing it a cappella. And a cappella is a cappella. You can't say, hey, look at this great music. Well, people say, well, it's a cappella. Now, where's the band? We want a band. Well, there's no band. I'm just a lone singer, which is not even a cappella. It's soloing, really. Usually a cappella, you have more than one person. Well, you're just kind of soloing. And I say, well, who do you think you are? You think you can change the world by soloing? That's insane. They'll say that. Your expectations are completely insane because you think you can make a difference by this. And we've become very cynical about people making a difference, like a single person. We used to be a single person really could make a difference, and we valued that tremendously. I remember when Roger Bannister ran the 4-minute mile, and everybody said, holy cow, that was impossible, and someone did it, and we can do it, because he did it, we can do it. And everybody, so many people started trying to run track and field at that point and said, we want to run a 4-minute mile. It became a big, track and field became a big, big deal, really. I think from Roger Bannister breaking the 4-minute mile. That was a huge deal in our time because it was like a barrier that we thought couldn't be reached. People sailing around the world, people doing these audacious things that really galvanized people. It happens today, but it's in a different way. We've lost our innocence. And especially if you have somebody saying, hey, the end of the world's coming, or the end of the cycle, and the mind, get ready, December. I've not seen a single indication of December 21st, 2012. I move around constantly, every day, and I have not seen a single indication, not one. A few people have kind of joked about it. No one's been serious about it. Maybe one person kind of serious about it, but nobody's willing to be serious about it, really, other than maybe an extreme exception. which, again, is not a movement. There is no movement afoot to take this seriously. There is no movement afoot at all. So, reading the room, I can't go out in a white suit, in a top hat, on the corner, with a tambourine and a sign and start jumping up and down like one of those sign people, have those arrows, opening, pizza place, opening, come in, special, one large pizza, $6.99. And I've seen these guys, some are like really talented, holy cow. I almost feel like going in just because they're so talented. But imagine if you had a sign saying, end of the world, December 21st, or ET agenda will be unveiled soon. And come on. No, people are just going to deride you. I don't particularly want to find out what it'll be like, because it'll probably be shocking. Because I'm not someone who expects to be derided much. Because I know what I am talking about is founded on tremendous effort and clarity and enormous research and awareness. And so I take it very seriously. So if other people just deride it, completely deride it, it doesn't sit well with me at all. I say, why am I doing this? That's stupid. I should have read the room better. Jesus said, don't cast pearls before swine. Exactly the same thing. You don't go out on a limb like that. If you read the room and realize that people are just going to laugh and ridicule you and deride you and think that you're a nutcase, you don't do that. You don't do that, really. Now, on YouTube, I read the room and I said, there's a lot of people on YouTube who are aware that there's this agenda taking place, and they're aware that they're in the crosshairs, and they're aware that their future doesn't seem good at all, and they're very alarmed, et cetera, et cetera. So I said, hey, this is a place where we can discuss these things. And of course, a lot of people want to battle it out. And what I've been trying to do with my two channels, I have a number of channels, but with Clarity Ross and Christ Clarity, is to say, don't fight it out. Read the room. You're going to lose that battle. You're going to lose the battle. The ETs are going to snap. And when they snap, you're going to be in big trouble. You're in over your head at this situation. You've got a bad hand. You've been dealt a very bad hand. However, you can fold the hand and sidestep the situation. So I keep beating that drum here on YouTube. Maybe I'll wear a white suit with a tambourine here and beat the drum, although I gave away all my tambourines, and say, hey, don't fight it, fold it. Don't hold them, fold them. Fold your hand. Don't fight it out with the situation coming up. It's a losing hand. You don't hold a winning hand at all. You do not. And why try to play a losing hand and push all your chips in. That is just stupid. Again, this is all hypothetical situation existence. So what victories do you need to win? You don't need to win any victories. You simply need to take the path, gravitate. See, right now, I choose to gravitate on the path of gravitating towards accepting reality as it is. I choose to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is. Right now, I choose to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is right now. Right now, I choose to gravitate towards accepting reality as right now. That's the only victory there is to choose accept reality as it is. That's it. There are no other victories, meaningful victories whatsoever. It's not a victory over anything. It's just an acceptance of reality as it is. So don't think that you need to win some battles in existence. You don't. You don't need to win any battles. None. You just need to be wise. Just need to be a lot wise. Lao Tzu, when Lao Tzu left China, he realized he had the losing hand and people weren't listening anymore. He said, I got time to leave. He folded his hand. And that's when he gave out the Tao Te Ching at the border, supposedly. As they left, they said, hey, give us something. We need to just give us something before you leave. He said, okay. But, he left. Folded his hand. So, hey, he recognized the situation. We can do the same. We can recognize the situation. We're not here to win any battles. Nobody's here to win any battles. Those who are wise are not here to win any battles. Not here to triumph over anybody. We're not here to triumph. We're not triumphing over anybody. We're not interested in triumphing. What meaningful triumph can there be in existence? None. It's not a triumph. Acceptance of reality is not a triumph over what? There's nothing that needs to be triumphed over. Reality is not threatened by anything. Reality's not in conflict with this dream. It's not threatened by it. Just ignores it, completely ignores it. It's not even there. It's just a hypothetical. So there's no triumph. No battles need to be won. We simply need to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is. The path I choose and consent to the path of gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. Right now I choose to consent to gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. That's the maybe the full mantra, part of the giving out part of the mantra here. A new mantra, giving it out right now. I choose and consent to gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. It's my choice and my consent right now to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is right now. There, improved mantra. It's my choice and my consent right now to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is right now. Boom! There's the mantra. You see? If you've been watching this video all the way, you got the mantra. I choose and consent right now to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is right now. Or you can say, I choose and consent right now to the path of accepting, of gravitating towards accepting reality as it is right now. Let's see. It is my choice and my consent right now to gravitate along the path to accepting reality as it is right now. There you go. I used to be a songwriter. Wrote a lot of songs, a lot of songs. And I worked on the lyrics. I was able to, of course, you work on the lyrics and you work and retool and retool and retool the song over and over until you get it right. So it is my choice and my consent right now to gravitate along the path of accepting reality as it is right now. There you go. You've got the lyric now. That's the, my babies, all these the one that's done the things they've never done, and that's because of that they say, hey, boom, boom. It's like that very smooth, smooth lyric, smooth mantra. It is my choice and my consent right now to gravitate along the path of accepting reality as it is right now. How's that? I hope you like it. That's a powerful mantra. Very powerful mantra. You use that mantra and you will find tremendous shift in subtle shift, because you'll feel like you have the capacity to recognize that you're holding a losing hand and you don't need to win any battles, and you'll be willing to fold your hand and sidestep the troubles, and you will gravitate along the path towards accepting reality as it is right now. So right, there's my choice and my consent right now to gravitate along the path towards accepting reality as it is right now. As it is reality, as it is right now. Not as it is tomorrow. Reality doesn't have a tomorrow. It only has the eternal now. Because tomorrow implies a change. Of course, we know tomorrow things will have changed a lot in this world. But reality doesn't change like that. It expands. It doesn't change. So the way reality is, it's that way right now. So we can only accept it right now. That's the only... It's always the way that it is. We shouldn't be waiting for it to change or to be fixed or healed or something. No. It's that waiting that is the problem. We keep waiting, waiting, waiting. No, we need to say no right now. I accept it right now. So it is my choice and consent to gravitate along the path towards accepting reality as it is right now. That's the mantra. That's the, we'll call it the end of the world mantra. End of the world mantra. Maybe I'll title the video the end of the world mantra. All right. Very great. And we will wrap it up right now because I'm probably turning into an ice cube. Okay. Very great. We will continue on. One more time. It is my choice and my consent right now to gravitate along the path towards accepting reality as it is right now.